Could you please welcome to the Twilight School stage, Rosalie Ham. Rosalie, why is it that 90% of this audience are women? Do you have a theory about that?
There's nothing wrong with women. There's nothing wrong. I'm pleased that they're all here. I love them all dearly. I don't even mind the odd bloke.
I really worked hard to entice the blokes. I think I should hand the stage over to Bernie so we could make this an all women. Tell us about Chirildery. What kind of town was it when you were a little tacker?
It was a town like any other town. And I think that that's what... why the book The Dressmaker was so appealing. I wrote The Dressmaker because they told me at RMIT when I enrolled in the writing course there many, many years ago that they said to me, your first novel doesn't get published. You basically what you do is you write, get everything off your chest in your first novel, and then if you've got anything to say after you've done that, then you could possibly be a writer that might change the world, you know, that or add something to the world. So I wrote The Dressmaker thinking that it would not get published. And I, as you say, I had travelled, and I travelled quite a lot. And one of the things I understood was that most small communities have similarities. They share certain things. And so when I sat down to write The Dressmaker, I put all of the things from Chirildery, but they're everywhere else as well. So that's the secrets and the duality and the truth and the hierarchy and the secrets that are told and the secrets that are not told. Don't dance with the Presbyterian minister. He holds you too close. You tell that secret. And you say nothing about the kid in the middle that's got brown eyes and brown hair when everybody else is a blue-eyed blonde. Those sorts of secrets, you don't say anything about those. So there was hypocrisy and bigotry and vanity and all those sorts of things that I saw.
Did you see them as a little kid as
yeah,
well?
Yeah, no, because they filter so? Down. There? Everybody knows, everybody... Because Chirildery only had 800 people at the most. And you kind of knew what was going on and you knew what to say and what not to say. And so that is what maintained the equilibrium and that is what the town kept... how the town kept ticking over without any disasters. And I just stuck it all in the...
So your book was meant to be this kind of exercise in a creative writing course.
A bit like that. But yeah. That said, in the creative writing course, you're with a whole lot of other writers, and of course there's competition, and you want to write better than anybody else. So you put everything in.
And are the teachers going, you're onto something, Rosalie? This is good. Are you getting a sense as you're building this thing that this might really develop into something beyond your expectations?
I knew in that writing class that there were certain things that were resonating, and I also knew that people lost interest when it was predictable. And that was the most valuable thing, that when it was not predictable and when you could surprise the other people in your class, then I kind of knew that I was onto something.
Was it your teachers instilling you with that notion, if you're going to write, don't make it predictable? Did you need that kind of almost rammed into you to kind of realise that, or was that something you were realising of your own accord?
I think I realised that on my own, and I think it has purely to do with the fact that I was trying to do well, and I did actually set out to do something different. But mostly I think it had to do with my peers. Like the teacher's just basically the facilitator, and they can give you exercises to do and tell you certain things, but if you're in a room full of 15 people with different ideas about everything, you realise that you're not going to appeal to everybody and nobody's sure. ever going to be happy. Sure. But if you stick to your guns and if there's a couple of people that like what you're doing, then you just keep going. And if you get to the end of the year and you think, okay, that's fine, I've said it all, and off you go, that's the way it will be. But that's the other thing about the writing course. If you come back next year and you front up and there's four people from last year, you think, okay, you know, we're down to four, let's keep going. So all of those things were good.
Was it a fraught experience too, in that having to subject something that you're giving your heart and soul into, and people are going, you know, making kind of comments about it and critiquing it? Was that hard to cope with?
For some people it was, and those well, they just didn't come again. So that was, you know. But I also knew because I had a teacher called Anthony Yark, and at the same time he was teaching us about writing, he was talking to us about the process of getting published. And basically he said, if you're not willing to take criticism and if you're not willing to listen and improve, you're not going to get anywhere. So I kind of... And you also learn from the other people which advice to take and what not. Like, I could never take advice from someone who likes science fiction because I just don't want aliens in any of my books, you know. So you so kind of learn
put
stuff
an alien
like,
in
yeah,
there,
yeah,
you're going to resist that. I'm interested in what kind of kid you were, though, Rosalie. Yeah. As a, let's say, a kid in grade six, are you wandering the hills of Gerildery on your own? Are you writing love letters to boys? What are you doing? What is it about you that goes, I'm going to head towards a creative kind of occupation?
I'm just delighted that so many people laughed when you said the word hills in Gerildery.
There's no hills.
There are absolutely hills. There is no
How
hills.
Poor is my research?
You just need to travel more. No, you just need to travel more.
When you were wandering the flatlands of Gerildery.
Yeah.
What were you thinking about? Truly, what kind of kid were you?
Well, do you know, I think the flatlands of Gerildery had a lot to do with... I talked with Sue Maslin about this. She produced the film of The Dressmaker, and we're both from Gerildery. And we talk about the vast expanse and how that... There is no horizon, there are no buildings to block your imagination or where it could go. So your imagination just sails off over the horizon. And I had a big imagination. I had a cast of thousands in my head. I would go to the sale yards and play on my own because there wasn't a lot of other kids around, I seem to remember. I think I quite liked my own company. But if I went to the sale yards to play, I would turn it into a mansion. I didn't read...
Are you speaking to people or is this all happening internally?
Oh, yes. And I thought that I wanted to be a famous actress, you know. And so I just had a big, fat story in my head the whole time. But the other thing was, and I think this was really important too, was around me was the life cycle that you only get on a farm or in a small community, life, death, universe, love, hate, tragedy, jealousy, bigotry... All those sorts of things were part of my everyday life. And so that made me, that just enriched my own internal life. And I did my chores. I chopped the wood and I, you know, did what I had to do to get 20 cents a week or 2 shillings or whatever it was. And so it was
Were there
good.
Any
I was
moments
good.
In that kind of playfulness that you thought, I am going to write a book, I am going to do something with this, this will lead me into my vocation?
No, because in those days, I did actually write a book when I was 11, but...
What was it called?
I can't remember, but I do have it. It's got a plot, and interestingly, the biggest aspect about that very small book is its irony. So I had a sense of irony even as a young kid, but no, because everybody just said... You're going to be a nurse or a teacher when you leave school. So I just thought I had to do that. So that's what I did. You know.
But you loved drama class. Did you have drama class?
Oh, yes, I know. I loved play acting and drama. And I loved all that stuff. And I remember being asked, what do you want to do when you grow up? And I said, I want to be a famous actress. Yeah. Yeah. I still might be.
Couldn't you have demanded to have a part in your own film?
Oh, no, I did. Didn't you see me?
I did.
I was there for at least 2.5 nanoseconds. And then my arm, I had my arm was in one scene, all of that part of my arm.
Is that right? It was the most beautiful scene, I reckon.
Yeah, thank you.
I fainted at that scene when I saw that arm. You've probably... I'm going to ask you to do something that might be a little bit difficult, and I'm not trying to put you in the hot spot. But I'm thinking about you having written a book and then someone come along and then made it into a film.
Yes.
If you had to have an opening scene of your own life story, what would the opening scene be? Rosalie Ham.
My own life story. I've never been asked that question before. But
I'm just trying to get a sense of the kind of landscape and what you'd be doing in it.
Do you know, I think it might be the opening scene from The Dressmaker, because I had that sense as a kid growing up. It was a small, tight-knit, loyal, supportive, helpful, wonderful community as they are, and it had those sort of nasty undercurrents. But one of the most fascinating things that used to happen in Gerildery is that a bus would come every day. And it used to come around about the time we got out from school, and someone would get off that bus. And I could just hear that Western music now, because we would always look at that person and go, I wonder what their story, what's the story behind that person. And so in that little enclosed world that I lived in, that was actually quite vast, there was always the outsider coming in. And that was the thing that intrigued everybody at the outset. Who is this person? And some of the, as I like to say, some of those people were on the next bus out, and some of them are still there.
Were you the kind of person that would imagine a history to those people, and you would make up scenes for them and imagine them in stories and predicaments and all sorts of stuff?
Yeah, and I still do, and I bet you do too.
I think I do when I'm on trains a little bit.
Yeah, I bet you do. I think a lot of people do. I do. Yeah. I like to look at people and think, I wonder if they're having an affair or things like that.
How many people in this room do you think
are having an affair?
There's a few people looking sheepish.
Yeah, they are. There's a few people flushing red.
Is that imaginative life still as vibrant and as kind
Damn.
Is it still on kind of overload as ever?
Does it
dim a bit as we get mature?
I think because you get family and friends and bank cards and mobile phones and things like that, it's, I find now, and I don't think this is true for you, I think you've probably got a fairly vibrant imagination most of the time, but if I want mine to kick in...
Are you interviewing me at the moment?
No, I'm just discussing.
No, I know.
But I think, for me, if I really wanted to nail something or get something or get in touch with something or feel something or... You know, so it goes out of my mind and down my arms and onto the page. I go away. I'll book into a motel in Yay or Gisborne or somewhere like that. And I'll sit in the motel with my pen and paper, not so much a computer, and a manuscript or a synopsis or something other, and that's the only way I can do it, if I just stay in my tracksuit pants. I love it. And just eat breakfast out of a cup in bed, and working, you know, that kind of thing. That's the most fun I ever have.
Geez, at the other end of the spectrum to all those wonderful dresses and things in your book, isn't it?
Yeah.
Tracksuit pants.
But they come in my imagination, so.
Wonderful. Yeah. Mm. Next time you're in one of those hotels, ring me, because I'd like to come and say hello. Not with any evil intentions. I just mean I'd like to see the way you work. So I don't know where that's...
It's not pretty, I tell you.
Dungata. How do you come up with a name like Dungata? Is it... Were you being playful? Were you being a bit silly? Were you being a bit preposterous and going... Were you throwing all these crazy ideas?
I was. And of course, the sound of that word.
What Dungata. Did you like about it?
Like the association with dung, principally.
Really?
And the fact that I knew who was going to be in it, and I knew the kind of people they were going to be...
Okay.
And so I just came up with Dungata. But interestingly, the word dunnage I found in a dictionary, and it means extraneous ballast and things that you chuck off a ship, excess baggage. And I thought that was a fabulous name, and I thought that I'd invented that as a surname. And then one day I got an email from some people in the United Kingdom, and they said, why did you use our name? And I just kind of wrote back and told them why I'd picked that name and pointed out that it was associated with beautiful fashion now, and tried to kind of get my way. And they said, it's already been done. We make top hats, and we have done for 250 years and why. And I kind of went, isn't that a coincidence? But they weren't going to be appeased at all. They thought I misused their name. But, I mean, how could you not use a name like Dunnage? I mean, for goodness sakes.
And some of the other names, the Almanacs and Councillor Pettyman, that's obviously... Yeah. Is that a shot at all politicians too?
Bloody oath.
Yeah.
Oh, my God, yeah. Especially now. But those names, I look back on those names and I think, they're a little bit sort of writing school.
Yeah.
But...
And the teacher Prudence Dim.
Yeah, and things like that. And I think they're a bit obvious. But people don't mind that. People seem to quite like that. So I'm just going to let go with it. I can't change it, so just be pleased about it.
Yep. Tell us about the first moment of the first character or the first bit of landscape that you looked at, and you, which was the beginning point of where this whole township grew and this whole community. Was there a moment that you can identify where you go, I can see this transvestite policeman, you know? No. Was there a... Where did it grow from? What was the first flicker?
It was, I mean, because that thing, write what you know, but you don't really know that you're writing what you know. So if you look at the landscape of Dungatar, it's pretty much the same as Geraldry. And somebody pointed that out to me. So, and I wasn't even conscious that I was doing that. I just, it was just whatever your imagination's been furnished with is what you use. And that's sort of basically what I did. But I knew that I wanted a hill. And I wanted the people, I knew about metaphor, and I knew that the people that were looking down on the Dunnage family were actually looking up to them. And in Geraldry, there are no hills, and hills were a very big thing
very
in my
flat.
Childhood. Yeah. But there was one hill in Geraldry. It was halfway between Geraldry and Narrandera, and it was actually an overpass over a railway line. And we used to look forward to that every year going over that when we went Christmas shopping. But no, I just knew that I had to have a very good... All the people in the town had to be able to get around and see each other. It had to be small, had to be flat so that you could see in each other's windows and you knew what was going on. But Tilly had to be above it so she could actually see, look down on it and know exactly what was going on. And I wanted a landscape similar to the Geraldry one, because I have this abiding memory of being a kid and looking across a sea of people at the Geraldry races. And it was a stinking hot, shocking day. And all around me were ladies dressed in couture, because I was a kid and everybody had a sewing machine. And so everybody looked amazing except for the people in shorts and thongs and singlets. And I wanted that. So they were the only things, and they were just in my head, so they just came out.
But the main protagonist of a woman who's gone away and she can do the
revenge.
Know, this revenge in this fashion revenge. Thing. Why that? What were you trying to say about creativity and fashion and all of that? Were you saying it can have a transformative kind of effect on people?
It does. That? Oh, I do. I know that to be true. That if you... As the quote at the start of the book says, if you put on something nice and new and pretty, you feel better. And I saw that because my mum was the seamstress in the town. There were many seamstresses in the town, but my mum was pretty good. And I've seen her make a wedding dress in 3 weeks for a very hurried up wedding. And she made all sorts of things. And I would see women come in and stand on her kitchen table while she was pinning their hem, talking about things that I should never have heard about while I was holding the pin tin. And they would say, I want to look better than Elspeth Beaumont. I need to look better than Mrs. O'Brien. Or I want to wear a mini skirt and my mum say, look, I just don't think, you know, and I knew that she was thinking, you don't have the knees for a mini skirt. And so I saw all that, but I also saw a lot of women walking out feeling better about themselves and then being able to step into any situation because they felt fabulous. And so they were more confident. And as Gertrude in the film and the book did, she rose up the hierarchy because of the way other people saw her or perceived her, which wasn't herself, because the costumes were hiding the flaws, the costumes as disguise, costumes as language, costume as freedom, and also entrapment. All those sorts of things were in my head as well, because you've got to think of a theme when you write a novel. They say, well, what's it about? What's it really about? And you think, oh, shit, what's it going to be about? And so you have the sort of moral thing underneath.
So 15 years on, Rosalie, after...
Yeah.
Is the book a different book to what you thought you were writing? Are people writing back to you and seeing things in it and you're going, gee, I didn't even realise that was there. I didn't realise those themes were there. Is the book still a revelation to you in some ways?
Absolutely. And that's a wonderful thing, because everybody brings themselves to a book. And so the way they interpret it through the filter of themselves, and we're all different. So people have found things in that book, you're quite right, that I didn't know were there. And it's been lovely for me to see how other people's minds work and how that happens. And I'm thrilled to bits. But the thing I love most is that people come up to me looking feverish with a gleam in their eye saying, I know those people. I know all of those people in that book. And they just unload all this stuff from their childhood and stuff like that. And you kind of have to be a bit of a counsellor. But they're the two joys. The fact that other people read it differently to the way I intended, they either like it or not, and the fact that it also works on a level where people identify with it. And that's, if you, as a writer, if you do that, then you've done something that you're meant to do.
Is there a part of you, Rosalie, that goes, I wrote that 15 years ago and I'm still talking about it and I'm doing all this other stuff and I wish people would ask me about that too, because that's out in the world now and it's kind of got a life of its own. Are you frustrated that we're talking about your book now, for
not
example?
Yet. Not yet. But I do
think
you'd
have every right to, in a sense.
No, I'm sort of quite happy because it... because people like the book and they want to hear stuff about it, and so I'm happy to do that. And I know perfectly well that other people will pick up the other two books. I've just finished my fourth novel, but I've got to rewrite it. I've got to cut 40,000 words, so it's got to be a while off. But no, I don't think I'll ever get tired of talking about that book, because it's been such a joy and a delight and a surprise, and I paid off my mortgage.
It sold about 150,000.
Yeah.
Is that right?
It's a little bit more than that now.
Yeah. Mm. That's a big amount in the Australian publishing context,
yeah,
isn't it?
Huge. And even over the 16 years or 15 years that it's been out, that's a huge amount. So I you can knock me over with a feather.
If anyone had said to you, your book
thanks.
Is going to...
Thanks for buying it.
Okay. If someone had said this book is going to sell, you know, kind of 1,000 copies, you wouldn't have believed it.
No. In fact, I didn't think. I thought that it would sit on the shelf with the other 1,000 books and no one would... I thought it would sink without a trace and that my mother would never read it. That didn't happen.
Your mother did read it?
She did. She did.
What did she think
of it? Oh, she said, darling, that was lovely.
That's it?
That's all she said.
Yeah.
Oh, she had to say something. What could she say? I mean, there's an awful lot of
things. Is there a bit of your mother in one of the characters in the book?
Only in the sense of the seamstressing and the sewing and the fact that I got a lot of information about how small communities work and what keeps them ticking over because she was a seamstress.
For the sake of a few who might not have read the book, do you mind if we just... If I just give you a name, if you could just give us a 30-second kind of introduction of who they are. Molly. Tell us about Molly. Molly Dunnage.
Molly Dunnage is the woman who was perceived to have done something wrong, and the entire town united in a lie to protect themselves against the fear of the Lord Mayor or whatever he's called now, I don't know what they call him now, Shire President. But Molly Dunnage is a woman who has done nothing wrong, but everybody's blamed her for doing something wrong, but she's on top of a hill and so she's in their conscience. And so they know that she knows that they know that she knows that they've done something terrible and it's not her. But she was also an homage to the little old lady in a small country town that lives in the warped house with the vines growing through the window. That's probably a little bit malnourished and a little bit dehydrated and a bit blind and a bit deaf. And so she doesn't see that she's wearing not so nice clothes. And she looks as if she's alone and no one cares, but actually most people are looking out for her. Because you would notice if a light didn't come on in one night and someone would check. So that's who Molly is. She's also enormously entertaining and my secret self when I'm going to be old.
I spoke to Sophie Laguna about a book, The Eye of the Sheep, and I said to her, you've created all these characters. And I said to her, do you love them all? And she said, apart from one, she did. Mm. Even the father who was alcoholic and could really be, you know, do awful stuff.
Mm.
Can I ask you the same question? You've created a whole town. When you look at them, and some you obviously kill off and they come to ghastly kind of endings.
That was good.
Do you care about them all? Does a writer care about the characters?
Yeah.
And are they believable? Do they get a life of their own so that they're almost as believable in your life as real people are too?
You have to care about them, because if you don't care about them, it comes out on the page and the readers don't connect with them and they don't like them and they don't care about them. So you have to sort of love them or like them, and if they're evil, you've got to find one redeeming feature so the reader's got some relief and something to cling on to. And I've forgotten the second part of the question. What was the second part of the question?
I've forgotten too.
What was the second part of the question?
Because Alice Pung says I asked triple.
Oh, I like them all. Yeah, I like them all.
Do you like them all?
I do like them all. I like them all. They've paid off my mortgage. Why would I not like them? They're lovely. Yeah. And they're good. I mean, I'm fond of them all. I'm even fond of Evan Pettingman, but only because Marigold got her own in the end and he got his just desserts, so I think, well, it wasn't so bad.
So you like people who get their comeuppance?
Yes, doesn't everyone?
I like it when Hawthorne loses the grand final, I must say. Yes,
yeah, I'm a bit pleased about that too, but don't say anything.
The poet Yevtushenko wrote a poem called People, and I remember reading it 10 years ago, and I think the awareness I got out of it was that when someone dies, a whole world dies. I'd never thought of that before. Mm-hmm. So I'm very intrigued with what writers do in terms of creating these hugely believable people who have a life of their own, who engage with audiences in all those ways that you beautifully described in that. Mm-hmm. How do you get all these complex characters to all kind of come together in this very complex world? How do you get all of that to hang together and have a kind of credibility about it and a believability? I just thought that would be just so mind-bogglingly difficult that it would just fall apart, but it doesn't.
Well, there are ways. I think the first thing you need to do is you need to be in love with what you're writing and really enjoying what you're doing, and then it just stays with you. You don't ever lose it because you like it and you're enjoying it, and so it stays with you. The other thing is you make notes, and I get a big, huge book and I write down who's doing what and where and how that's
really
happening. Yeah, and that's a way of also developing motifs too. So if you've got one little thread, one character has got one particular character trait, or they own a dog or there's something, it's a way of being able to see that and loop that dog back in so he's in on a regular basis. So once you've got the huge structure all done, then you've got to go back to your piece of paper and thread it in. And if they go to the newsagents, you've got to make sure he's got his dog with him and, you know, stuff like that. But as I say, the secret is to love what you're doing and isolation so that you can focus on it and it all hangs together.
So writing is like sewing. I'm not being flippant.
No, it is. You're quite right. Yeah. It is. Absolutely is. It's a dedicated craft. You've got to be tenacious. Above everything else, you've got to be able to sit in a room on your own for 4 years.
Why would you do that? And as
I don't know.
No, I'm not. I'm glad that you do, because if you didn't do that, we wouldn't have these to talk about. But I could imagine that I would find a million things. I'd look out the window and I'd see something out there that would want to entice me out. And then you don't know that it's all going to work. I mean, the whole thing could be a giant flop.
It's silly, isn't it?
So what keeps you going? Where's the belief? Where does the belief come from?
I don't know. People have asked me that question before, Bruno, and I just don't know. I think because you've got, I think it's got to do with the idea. Because if you set out on a journey and a process, there's something you want to say. Like the fourth book I'm writing at the moment, it's about irrigation water. And so I had to organise it so that it was around 12 kilometres of irrigation channel, and that 12 kilometres of irrigation channel was the heart and soul of a small community. And without that, it affected the whole environment. So, and I've forgotten again what you asked me. Wasn't that terrible?
What keeps you at it?
What keeps it apart? It's the
it?
Idea. It's the message. It's what you want to say. It's like I'm desperate to get out to people what happens about water and how the whole thing around water works. And there is corruption and there is water trading, and when you take water from a community, you take jobs and there's all sorts of repercussions. So that's got up my And I'm listening to myself talking, I'm getting strident, I'm getting really upset about it. And that's what's keeping me going back to that bloody office every day and sitting down and going through it, because it's the idea, it's what I want to say.
It sounds a bit manic. So if I come into that room in Yay, you've got pieces of paper everywhere, and there's this forensic kind of mapping of stuff too.
A little bit.
And everything has to kind of be woven back into it, hasn't it?
But it's usually all contained to the bed. Like, it's usually, you know, I don't put things on the wall or anything quite yet, but I do establish. And writers do. They do. There's very few writers that I know that have just got a keyboard and a screen. Most of them have got notes and bits of paper and old envelopes stuffed in their bag and a faraway look in their eyes when you're trying to talk to them, because they're still ticking over.
Are you missing out on something because you've got to be in that relentless kind of creative, in your head kind of space?
You've got to be really disciplined. So if you've got a deadline, you've got to be able to say, no, I can't come to my grandson's five-year-old party. I, of course, am not doing that. I'm going to mine. But you should be able to do that. And that's why I say, if you remove yourself completely, if you go to Yass or Mangalore or the Gambia or somewhere like that,
you
just forget about all of that stuff. But if you're there, and if you do stop on the way to the typewriter and wash a cup, then you'll do the whole house, and you'll do the bathrooms and the windows and the fence posts and the car and the neighbour's car, and you'll never get there. So you don't do that. You go straight there, and you only let yourself finish when you've done what you said you were going to do that day.
Does the purpose that you have, is there a great social purpose to it as well as it being something you need to do? Do you go at the end, this book will go out into the world and hopefully it will do something, it will trigger something, it will shift someone. Is that important too, or is that too grandiose to think that my art might have that impact on people?
I think that's why you've got to do it. I think that's why we do it. Otherwise there wouldn't be kind of much point. But even if I come to an occasion like this, and if one person came up to me and said, I really enjoyed Summer at Mount Hope, or I really like There Should Be More Dancing, then I'm happy, because one person's enjoyed it, and that's good. So, yeah.
Graham Greene, at the age of 80, was being interviewed, and he was asked something, and he said, I've lived more with fictional characters than I have with real people.
Yeah.
He says, I've succeeded a great deal, but I failed in terms of kind of knowing real people too a little bit. I'm not suggesting that's the case, but I'm just wondering, is there a little bit of that tension about things that have to be given up in order to
But Graham Greene had he used to go to an island. He had a lovely island in the Caribbean or near Greece or somewhere like that, and his neighbour was Shirley Hazard. Graham Greene, and he always had some lady or friend or someone that looked after him and did his shirts and his washing and ironing and stuff like that. And he wrote many, many brilliant books, and he was able to do that, and I'm very happy for him. And if I could be Graham Greene, I would.
Yeah.
And I'd love to go to Greece, and I'd love to do things like that.
And he went to Mexico and Haiti and a lot of all the problem
sorts
spots,
of places.
Didn't he?
Yeah, he did, and he was
intrepid. Do we have to go to the problem spots? Because Helen Garner doesn't, does she? She goes into the domestic and stays up close, and her art is great, isn't it?
Except for the courtrooms one. She went to the courtroom one. Yes, that's what she...
Yeah.
And if I wanted to write about wars, I would feel that I had to go there. But I think I will probably not... I think I'll spend more of my life with real people, because at the rate I write and the amount of other stuff going on in my circumstances, I'm just really hoping it gets quiet in about 3 years and everything stops and I get the last 30 years of my life, and then I'll write 7 more novels. But at the rate I'm going, it's not looking good.
Rosalie, the filmmakers come to you and they go, we're going to make the film of your book. Is there a possessive part of you that goes, no, I don't want that, because I have a contract with my reader that you are free to imagine my characters in whatever way you want to, and you're going to come along and you're going to nail those characters and give them a physicality and a whatever. Is that hard to do, or to give
not
that up?
Not when you've got a mortgage. No. Not at all.
The mortgage aside, is there a little bit of you going, then it becomes another... Does it become another story?
Well, it does, but I'm not sort of qualified to talk about this to a huge extent, because the girl that came to me and said she wanted to turn my book into a film happened to be someone that grew up in Girilderie. Yeah. Sue Maslin is her name, and she grew up in the same landscape I did. So when she said one day when we were playing golf, I'm going to turn your book into a film, is that all right? And I said, yes, you can, but I want to be in it. I knew that she was going to do something good. And I trusted her, and that's the key. If you find someone with a good idea and who recognises the character and knows what you're on about and doesn't really want to change that, then you're lucky. And this is an argument. You've brought up a really good argument that writers go through, because some of them won't. They won't have their film, their book made into a film because of that reason, because they love their characters the way they are. But there are some of us that go, shoot, if you want to put that on 40 feet high on a screen in Technicolor and lots of people go and see it and then buy my book, you go right ahead. But she, as I say, she was unique, Sue, because she...
has four main kind of sections: gingham, shantung, felt, and brocade.
Yeah.
Tell us about where you decided to do it that way, and tell us how fabric and the dressmaking and how you got literate in the art of talking about those kinds of things. I imagine you had to learn a whole new literacy too with it.
I did. But when I went to school, you did home economics and needlework. And I was around sewing my whole life. We all were. We all knitted in small country town. Or small communities. It doesn't have to be a country town. There are some communities that are that way inclined. So I kind of knew about it, but also I lived not far from the RMIT Brunswick textiles and fashion campus. And they have a fabulous library full of amazing books. So I used to go there a lot. And investigate. But as for the four, and I thoroughly enjoyed that. That was a very enjoyable thing to do, to go down and look at those books. It was very inspiring, very inspiring. So, and I lifted a whole lot of patterns from people and made them, awarded them to the good folk of Dungatar. But those, the silk, the brocade, whatever it was, and the slub, they have got absolutely nothing to do with me. That was something that the publishers did, because the shipping news had just come out and it had all those little knots at the start of each, and they went, that's a good idea, that book really sold, let's do some for you. And they tried to get me to do them, and I just wasn't interested. So Gail McCallum, the woman who edited the book, she found them and she stuck them in. Now I have no idea what they mean, and thousands of schoolgirls ask me and I say, I just don't know, I'm sorry.
Tell us about Tilly. If we just go back to introducing some of the characters for people who may... Just tell us, give us Tilly in a...
Getting even, revenge. Impossibly beautiful heroine with a tragic past. For drama, fabulous character. I picked her because I wanted a good, strong...
The tragic past
with an agenda.
Is that... Do all main characters need a tragic past?
No, they don't. But in the kind of gothic-y, over-the-top, evil thing that I was going to write, I needed someone that was impossibly beautiful, tall, could wear all those clothes, cool, calm. Her presence would be the catalyst for all the events that happened. And that's what I did. And so I just picked her. And I wanted her to be... her main attribute was her ability to be able to raise one eyebrow. And that would say many, many things. And so I just created her.
Can you raise one eyebrow? To
no, that? I never could. Something I've always wanted to do. I can cross my eyes though.
Your book is being made into a film and the early rushes are kind of coming out and obviously, are they letting you see it as it's being made?
No.
So when are you first having a look at what they've done with your book?
I was an extra, as I said, in the film and...
The arm.
My arm was in it. And so I basically saw it all happening around me. And I got off a bus in Dungatar and I met Tilly Dunnage and Molly and Evan Pettyman and William Beaumont. And I met all... Who's actually... his father is Hugh McKay, because James McKay is Hugh McKay's son and he plays William Beaumont. Okay. Yeah. So I met all of those people. And then at the end of the day, sometimes I would go and look at the rushes and I would look over their shoulder and see what they were... doing, but I didn't pay too much attention to it because I knew that I wanted to see the complete and wonderful Sue Maslin, Jocelyn Morehouse, Kate Winslet thing with all the costumes. And so I didn't see it for a very, very, very long time. And I saw it the day they showed it to the cast and crew. Okay. And
where are you sitting, down the back or are you right in the middle of
right
it all?
Right smack in the middle. Yeah. And I was surrounded by all the other extras who was my husband Ian, my husband Ian's friend Ivan and his wife Margaret, my brother Neville, my niece Hannah, my nephew Matthew, my other niece Catherine, my friend Meredith's sister and her brother-in-law, my friend Angela and a neighbour from Geraldry. And there we were.
That deserves a round of applause, Naya.
Yeah.
Were you like an excited school kid at that moment? Were
God,
you just
shocking.
Beside yourself? What,
we were.
Describe.
Well, my brothers, my family, they're nurses and farmers. They're irrigation farmers from Geraldry. And I just said, they're turning my book into a film. Do you want to be in it? And they went, oh, no, it's harvest. And I said, oh, it's got Kate Winslet. And they went, nah. And I said, it's got Judy Davis. And they said, well, who's she? And then I said, okay, it's got Shane Jacobson, and they went, yeah, all right. So they came down, and it was lovely. And I remember getting off the bus, and my nephew looked at me and said, we don't have to do any acting, do we? And I kind of went, nah, you'll be right. And, of course, he had to act for 12 hours. And it was from being on a header one day and then in a scene with Kate Winslet, it was quite an extraordinary thing for them, and I have to say that we all acquitted ourselves really well. The first week we were going, oh my God, there's Rebecca Gibney, and oh my God, this, and you know, getting being really.
They did pack all the who's who of Australian
acting,
did they?
They did.
Did they tell you they were going to do that?
Yeah, I kind of knew. But at the end of 3 weeks when we'd been there, and you've got to sit around for a very, very, very long time being an extra until they get you to sit here and look this, you know. But at the end of 3 weeks, we were all sitting there in our corsets in the stinking hot, and we just all looked at each other and went, if bloody Kate Winslet doesn't nail this scene, I'm going home. I can't stand it anymore. She's just got to get it right.
Really?
And so we would all glare at her going, you got to get this right, you know. So we just got over it very quickly because it was quite a painful thing.
I imagine everyone would have wanted to know from you, you've just seen the film, what you thought of it and that. Was that hard to kind of work out what your response was to something that is so intimately yours? Did you kind of go,
No, the magic, that's what happened. I went into that cinema, we all went into that cinema and we all sat down and we started watching this film, and at the end of the film we were all weeping. We all knew exactly what was going to happen and we were all weeping and we'd all laughed and we all looked at each other and went, that was a really good film. And it got us and we forgot to even look for ourselves. We just got carried away with the film. And we just went, that was a really good Australian film. That was a very well-made film. Wasn't that fabulous? And we were happy as clams.
And the weeping is at the sense of accomplishment as well as bits of...
Oh, possibly, yeah. Yeah. Because we were very proud of our work, you know. But also because it was good and they pulled it off. There's a huge amount of relief... Oh, there was a lot of relief for me for Sue because she had to find $17 million and you know, that's an enormous thing to make a film. And when the cinema stood up and started clapping, I mean, you can't help but weep when that happens, and everybody around you is thrilled to bits with themselves. It was good.
Did you feel a sense of responsibility as the story maker of this, that it had to work too?
No.
Given that $17 million, I mean, if they were going to put $17 million into an idea of mine, I'd be a bit nervous.
No, it was theirs. It had nothing to do with me. I just wrote the book.
Yeah.
It was their problem. Yeah. I got all of the glory and none of the pain. I had none of the responsibility. I went every day. I paid off my mortgage, as I said. And then I went every day.
This has really been a conversation about mortgages.
Oh, my God, it was so good. And in 15 minutes I did it. I paid the Commonwealth Bank, and then I paid my agent, and then I paid the tax department. And then I went and bought a bottle of Chanel, because that's all that was left. Everything else was gone.
Chanel number five.
Number five. And now I've forgotten again what you asked me. That's the third time I've done that.
That's okay, because it probably had three questions within one.
Yeah, no. You don't remember either, do you? What did he just ask me?
Because I...
I don't remember. No. Oh, no, I didn't have any responsibility towards it. I'd handed it over, and it was... I'd said, you can do whatever you want to do.
But it could have flopped big time.
Oh, it could have been shocking. It could have been shocking. But the thing was that Sue knew that she might make her money back because the book had sold well. It had been on the VCE lit list, and she'd done this huge... She's really clever, smart, wonderful person. She'd done a kind of a social media campaign. So she had thousands of people, you know, checking the Facebook, the Dressmaker Facebook scene, and she'd leaked stuff like the costumes and things were leaked. And so by the time it was released, there was a captive audience. There was a whole lot of people. And then, you get word of mouth. And if you get good word of mouth, that is what will make something happen. That is what happened to the book, and that's what happened to the film. And if it did flop, I knew that there would be at least 50,000 people that had read the book over 15 years that would come up to me and say, the book was better than the film. And I had that.
Are the costumes in themselves characters in a way in your story too? Do objects become characters sometimes?
They did in my book. I loved all my frocks in my book. And that was another thing. When they said Marion Boyce was going to do the costumes for the ladies of Dungatar, and I kind of watched Franny Fisher just for the costumes, and Marion was going to make them, and I just went, this is just too good to be true. This is going to be... lovely. I mean, and if nothing else, the costumes will appeal to all the millions of people out there that sew and make their own clothes and who are interested in fashion. And so my costumes, the ones that I so faithfully and beautifully stole and recreated for my characters from Christian Dior and Balenciaga and all those people, they remain. They will be in the book and they will stay there. But Sue's costumes are travelling all over Australia now. They're in Adelaide at the moment. And people are loving going and looking at them. So they're living on as Marion's characters, and they're living on in the book. So I'm perfectly happy with that.
When I said to you, Rosalie, come out, and I've interviewed you and Sue together, and I like that, please. Yeah. But I said, no, I just want to talk about your book too. Mm. Did you feel a part of you went, I need the costumes with me, I need Sue with me, We're an ensemble, no?
No? No, I'm the youngest in a family of four. I can talk about myself endlessly. It's fine.
The story is set in Dungatar in the 50s. Mm. It's kind of roughly the time that kind of we're born into. Are we fascinated with the world we're born into? Are we seeking to understand that in some way? Do you think that was partly what your book was about too? Because you could have given it a contemporary kind of setting.
I could have, but the
fashion
illegitimate child thing wouldn't have worked.
Yep.
I hope I haven't given anything away. Because nobody cares anymore. You can have as many kids as you like to whoever you like, and everybody goes, oh, that's nice. You get presents. I think the nostalgia for that time, and because and the way clothes were made and worn, and a way when everybody wore beautiful clothes and there was a bit more etiquette, the hats, the glove style rather than fashion, good craftsmanship, a sense of occasion, all those sorts of things appeal to people. They really liked it. That's one of the things people enjoyed a lot about that film. And of course, the universal themes.
Are you sad that those things are no longer with us? Or do you mourn their passing? Or?
Oh, well, no, you can't, because it's just the way it is. The world moves on, things progress. But there is still, people have a sense of occasion in a different way. We still have, within the family, most particularly, I think there are senses of occasion, even if they are birthday parties for grandkids or 25th wedding anniversaries or whatever they are. There's still that kind of sense of occasion, and people do still make a special effort. So I think that's lovely. It'd be nice if we could all wear hat and gloves, but I'm not real big on the corsets. I don't think they should bring them back.
I'm not big on those either.
No, they're bad for you. Bad for you.
I must confess, I like getting a new batik shirt and wearing
it.
Go in.
But you do feel, it makes you feel, you like it.
It does. It's kind of a signal that you're kind of stepping up into a kind of a more elevated realm, and you want it to be good, and you want it to be good for the folk there, and, you know, a little bit of that. But I wouldn't go get into that too
much. I went and did a bit of Christmas shopping this morning and bought myself a dress. Because I like buying dresses. It makes me feel good. So I'll do the Christmas shopping. There's plenty of time. It's only November or something. There's plenty of time to do the shopping.
Your book and your film have been translated into lots of different kind of cultures and places. Does it translate?
Yes, amazingly. It was hugely popular in South Korea, for goodness sakes. And, of course, Italy and Spain and Argentina and, like, these places you wouldn't believe just said, I know this place. They wrote to me. You have to get our Google Translator because I don't know what they are. But I get emails from people saying, I know all of these people in my small village in Russia. They are all here, or, you know, so stuff like that. So it's that sort of thing that it works on. And I'm really happy that it's translated. And all those other things, the fashion and...
Is it important to you for your book to be declared a great Australian book, for that film to be declared? Is that important, or do you move on and go, I'm interested in the next story and let it have a life of whatever it has of its own or whatever?
Well, it does have its own life, and it happened to... And people started coming to me and saying, oh, it's an Australian classic, and I think, I'm not quite sure. But I have written it. It is out there. People can do what they want with it, and there's always going to be a certain amount of people that are dissenting and saying no, it shouldn't be, or whatever. But as far as I'm concerned, if I write a novel, I send it out into the world, and then of course my thoughts turn to the next one. So it has a life of its own. If somebody comes back and says we want to turn it into a film or a play, or we want to turn it in, it's a classic or whatever, and you go, good, that's thanks very much, but it's not the focus of my life. The focus of my life is what's happening next.
Rosalie, if I said we've got a time capsule and we've only got 10 pages of your writing to go into it, could I just ask you to go, which are the bits of the book that you think are the most beautifully written? Are bits of the book that still, when you read back, you go, is that me doing that? I can't almost believe that.
I haven't read that book since it came out. You know, really...
Would that be hard to...
People ask me about things in The Dressmaker and I go, oh, God, I can't remember. Yeah. But I think possibly the film's brought it back to me. So the bit that I would include most definitely would be anything from the book that's got Barney McSwiney in it. And I think possibly...
Why is that?
Because I loved him. Him and Molly they're two of my favourite people. I love them deeply, and if I ever write a sequel, that's what I'm meant to be doing. Those two, well, not Molly, for other reasons. Don't say what happens to Molly.
I haven't read the end of your books since I spoke.
This
to
is just time. Getting worse. And
no,
worse
because I knew I was going to be speaking to you again, so I had to hold off. Truly, so I wouldn't blab.
Like, he doesn't know my other books. He hasn't read the end of this one, really.
No, I do. I do that deliberately now. I never read the endings of anyone's book. Yeah, I know. Sorry.
That's okay. It's a good ending. And Barney and Molly, and of course, the dastardly ending of the very horrible Evan Pettyman. And the play. the play. Yeah, when they come back on the bus, I think, yeah.
When you were creating these characters at the start, did you go, I know what their fate is?
No.
Or did you have to let that be a revelation to yourself?
I knew that it was going to be dastardly. I knew something terrible was going to happen, but I wasn't actually quite sure what. But I think it worked out all right in the end.
Have I exhausted you with my triple barrel?
No, like
questions?
I say, I can talk about myself endlessly. It's fine.
Can I quote Richard Flanagan to you?
Because I
want you to make a comment about where you think
yep.
writing sits and what it might do at
okay.
its very best and at its most powerful.
I'll try to remember.
Richard Flanagan said this a few years back. To the prison bars of hierarchy, of ladders, of official cultures, good books inevitably stand in opposition. Novels tend to be dirty, awkward, rebellious and confronting. A good writer, the unlisted Kafka, somewhere observes, should never be afraid of muck. Literature in this sense has always been the revenge of those on the outside, those not on the official list. I picked on that because revenge is a big theme in your book too.
Yeah.
Where do you sit in terms of what Richard's kind of saying?
I think
as a novelist?
I think that he's perfectly correct because, we've just recently read Barbara Bainton's The Chosen Vessel for the heck of it. I don't know if anybody's read that, but it's all of those things. It sits outside of everything and it's a brutal, raw, succinct, direct story, a great tragedy that says a lot about early Australia, misogyny, the bush city, mystique, and it's written by a woman and it's without sentiment, and it wouldn't have possibly got published in 1896, but for some reason it's not the kind of story that you would publish generally. It's not an entertaining, lovely thing, especially in 1896, but they did publish it and it is still here and it's still one of the favourites. And it's good literature. And I think if you think of any really good book, it is outside what people expect. And it does say something and it is confronting. And I'm not saying that books that follow a formula and are pleasant and lovely and entertaining are not worth anything. I think they absolutely are. But it's the good ones that are the bad ones, the naughty ones, the confronting ones. I think he's quite right. But gosh, his prose, the way he writes... You know, only someone in absolute confidence of their own abilities and in possession of their craft could sit down and write a sentence like that. I could write that paragraph on a really, really, really good day, but he might just sit down and, I don't know, he might spend all day and all night coming up with paragraphs like
Rosalie,
that.
Rosalie, a novel's the art form that can most deeply penetrate into the depths of a person.
I think so. I believe that to be the case. But you've also got to understand now that people don't read as much or as widely. They get stories in other forms. And I think what's happening is that screens are getting better at what they're doing. There's a huge amount of really good series and films and that say many, many things on many, many layers, and they're just as good. But I think with the book, what it is about the book, it is that it's so portable and you can sink into it whenever you want and you can carry it around with you. And if you've got a book, you immediately get a sense of leisure and time because it's something that you have to spend time doing. So in that way, I think the book is superior as well, whereas film could possibly be just as good, but it's a transient thing. But I honestly think if you're going to read a book and take the time to consider every word that the author has written down and why, and read between the lines and think about the issues beyond the book, then that's the purpose of a novel. And if they continue to do that, then some people somewhere are going to pick it up and do exactly that.
Rosalie, I teach occasionally and people will walk out after an hour and a half and I feel extremely privileged that they've actually allowed me to unfurl whatever thinking I have about the world.
Mm.
And they've sat there, and sometimes they even take notes. At the age of 63, I'm still gobsmacked by that.
Mm.
So I suppose I'm talking about your readers going, I loved your book, I really got into it.
It's amazing.
Something. Is that
amazing.
The ultimate reward for all those weeks of sitting in those dusty hotel rooms. And,
yep, it is.
Can I just go on? Richard Flanagan also says, novels arise out of the argument between a man or a woman and the world.
Yes.
Is he right about that?
Absolutely, because when I wrote The Dressmaker, the thing that got up my nose was all those things in it, the hypocrisy, the bigotry, the duality of the truth, the revenge, the bullying, all those sorts of things. They were the things that got up my nose, and I really wanted to say something about those. In Summer at Mount Hope, it was about how things in 1894 weren't that much different to now. Women are still having to choose between a job, family. You know, it's still dangerous for women out in the world, all those sorts of things. And in There Should Be More Dancing, it was about unresolved grief. And they were the things that sustained me through all of those books. Have I answered the question?
Yeah, absolutely.
Because I've forgotten what it is again.
I'm starting to feel very daunting in my questions.
No, it's me. Because I go off on tangents and
Rosalie,
then I think...
we're going to kind of end on a light note and,
oh, good.
And a playful note too. And I know there's the theatre background too. So we're going to play You're Just Too Good To Be True, Can't Take My Eyes Off of You. I'll do that later.
Okay.
John Marsden wrote a book titled Everything I Know About Writing. Okay.
Okay.
We're going to try and find out all the things Rosalie Ham knows about writing because we've got writing students in the class. So I'm going to ask for your distilled advice.
Do my best.
Within about a minute, just off the top of the head, okay?
Okay.
Okay. Give us some advice about creating characters.
If you've got... one thing that you love about your character, or even if it's their eyebrow or a personality trait, if it's an instinctive thing and you like it, you can build around that. But also, the writers know that if you get a character, if they're true and they're good and they're lovely, you can't get them to do anything that they wouldn't do. They kind of speak to you and they won't do certain things for you because it's not right. And then so you have to create someone else.
Powering the story. How does a story get momentum and go somewhere?
You've got to know where you're going. In my mind, my particular way of writing is that I've got to know where I'm going and I've got to know what it is that I'm saying, and then I've got to be able to say that. And keeping momentum is all about editing. Cutting out the stuff that people don't read, that they skip over. Because you can say a lot with a few words. I don't like being told how to think or feel or what stuff looks like. I like people to give me an indication, and I like using my memory bank to fill in the rest.
Less is more.
That's my personal one. Other people write long, beautiful, glorious sentences full of description, and they're wonderful. But I'm just... not, I don't have that ability. If I do write something like that, I'll invariably
How would you teach students? How would you get across the less is more kind of concept?
Michael Duffy did it for me in Summer at Mount Hope. I wrote this beautiful scene, and it was about an epiphany that my main character, Phoebe Krupp, had. And she walked metaphorically to the top of an outcrop, and she looked out across at the bay, and at that moment the clouds parted and a shaft of sunlight came down and sparkled on the bay, and it was illuminating, and she knew what she was going to do. And I'd gone to a great deal of trouble to describe the parting of the clouds and the colour and all that sort of stuff, and it was great and I loved it. And he sent the manuscript back and he had a line down beside that paragraph and he wrote, "It's just a cloud."
It's cloud's illusions, I recall. Tell us about beginnings. If we're going to write a novel or a story, tell us about beginnings.
The beginning isn't really the beginning. The beginning is actually you finding your way into the story. And you will write the first chapter and it'll be all this stuff. And it's good. You keep it there. You use it. You need it. And you probably rewrite that same beginning of 15 million times, but you're just procrastinating because you don't know where you're going with the story. But it's a therapeutic thing to do anyway. Tell yourself to stop rewriting the beginning and move on. And then when you've written what you're going to write, you put it aside and then you come back a couple of months later and you cut the beginning out.
dialogue.
Start on the second chapter, yeah. And also because people, you've got to have a hook in the first page.
We're still talking about beginnings here?
Yeah, sorry. You've got to have a hook. Sorry, I didn't hear the dialogue.
Sorry, I didn't mean.
You've got to have a hook in the beginning that it will carry the reader through. They've got to have a sense of anticipation and they've got to want to know what's going to happen. So you can't be indulgent. You've got to be provocative. Dialogue? I don't know what to say about dialogue. Dialogue, less is more. And also, it has to be believable to the character. Never write or and don't have many ellipses. Because people say and a lot, but they don't look good on the page. That's all I can do with dialogue at the moment.
Plot.
They change. There's arguments between what is story and what is plot. So I'm taking plot to be the sequence of events. It will change a lot. And it will change according to your characters. But if you know centrally what's going to happen and how it's going to happen, and more importantly, why, and more importantly, what that's going to mean. Like you write a book and it's about the relationship between animals and humans, and you can write about that, but you've got to say something about that relationship. So if you're going to have a good plot, you've got to know why you've got that good plot and what the other meaning is, and what people are going to get from that plot. And I quite like a good plot, but if I get to the end and go, that was good, what does it mean, and I can't come up with anything, then I think,
Endings.
They happen. Your ending might come sooner than you think. Oh, do you know what happens with endings? I've just thought of something. People power along like crazy till they get to the climax and the denouement, and they settle all the characters, and when they get to the ending, they've run out of steam and they're not written nearly as well as the rest of the novel. So you've got to stick at it, and you've got to write, the end has to be just as good as the beginning. That's my thing on
ending. Rosie, we're going to throw to the audience too, and while Bernadette Hetherington from Sunbury Community Health gets the microphone ready.
Put on your Bernadette.
Just to take us back where we started, you were sitting there, yeah. Rosie, at the start of the night,
yep.
You were kind of feeling the vibe of the room and having a glass of wine, and you're listening to those young boys talk.
Yes.
You seem to like all of that.
This is fabulous. It's fantastic.
Is it still important that people gather in a space?
It's meet what is it? It's Wednesday night. It's cold and wet and rainy. It hasn't been pleasant for years in this state. And you've got a room full of people, and you've got Bernadette and the community people here. It's lovely, and everybody was anticipating something good to happen. They're all ready, and everybody came with their wine and their food, and
they're all frocked up.
It's lovely.
I've got my Bardic
shirt. Yeah, no, people
made never. Are you frocking up internally at that moment, because you go, there's a spirit there that I'd like to kind of meet with something.
Yeah, well, you do, because the room kind of fills with energy, and so you kind of meet that energy, and yeah. and people have come along for a reason, so you've got to make a bit of an effort.
And what are you hoping that they will take away with them? What would you like to think that as they walk down that path, and mothers and daughters might be together, or fathers and sons, or lovers, what do you hope that they might take away?
I hope they go to the nearest bookshop and buy a book.
So
not mine, any book.
So I can pay your mortgage.
No, my mortgage is fine. They don't have to buy mine, buy someone else's. That's fine.
Would you like to help me pay mine? Could you please thank the irrepressible Rosalie Ham?
Thank you.
Have we tied you out? You don't mind a few questions?
Yeah, no, a few questions, that'll be good.
Who's got a question? You got the microphone? Tell us your name and stand up if you wouldn't mind.
Hi everyone, it's Melanie Fattori. I'm a teacher here. Rosalie, I just love the Dressmaker. And I love the bakery in Geraldry. I've been there many times. but I'm just intrigued about your next novel, because I'm a dairy farming daughter from Rochester. And I'm just wondering where and when it's set. And I'm already amused at what the costumes, if you can imagine it turning into a film, like Mum doesn't get out of anything but a flannelette shirt and tracksuit pants.
Yep.
What would,
yep.
you yeah. know, yeah, could you enlighten us about the next novel?
Well, it hasn't got many costumes in it.
No.
Like, it's not about that, but it's a, it's, as I said, though, just Hans sent it back to me and said, you've got to cut 40,000 words, so that's going to take me quite some time. But it's a sort of an ode to my childhood and the grumblings of my brother's irrigation farmers who were faced with that impossible dilemma that they had to sell some of their water in order to upgrade. But what happened in the meantime was if you sell water, then you lose equity in your farm. So you're paying a mortgage and loans that are not equivalent to what the farm is worth. And there's a kind of a gap. And because they never, which makes, you know, long-term averages and finances all very complicated. And the thing is, they never actually quite know how much water they're going to get. And they can't really plan 5, 10, 15, 25 years ahead because it's all so tenuous. And then occasionally you get a headline in the Weekly Times that talks about corruption and things like that. So it was basically a story about water and irrigation water and the effects on the community. But one of the notes that I got back when I sent it back was you have to make it less about the water. The water has to be a backstory. You've got to have more drama. And I was thinking, no, the drama is the water, don't you understand? So there's something that I'm missing between what I think I'm doing and what people want me to do. I've got to find somewhere so that my idea about water translates to people in Glen Iris that don't go past Craigieburn, but at the same time is entertaining for them. So that's what I'm struggling with at the moment. And the death of the Deathridge wheel and those big, amazing things that creep across the landscape now, and the fact that there's no channel so farmers can't get water for their sheep and all that stuff. Does that?
Yeah. Another question? Yeah, down here, the lady in, the woman in red.
Lady in red.
Asked a question just so you could say that. Hi, Rosalie. I'm Chris from the Community Health Centre. In terms of the Dressmaker, the movie, all the behind-scenes important roles, Sue, were mainly females, was that?
So just say that all the behind-scenes...
Yeah, the director.
Yep. Were they...
Females.
They're the girls, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah.
What I was saying, was that just coincidental or did you make that part of your...
No, that was just purely coincidental. And what it achieved, though, was something wonderful. Apart from bringing Jocelyn Morehouse back into the fold and giving her the confidence to come back after having four kids and all that sort of stuff, but what they really wanted to do was address the gender imbalance in filmmaking itself, and it's the same in many things, including this room. But it's there's not a lot of women that can get to positions of power within the film industry, and they made, I think, the year before last, they made 23 films in this country, and the three of them had a female protagonist as carrying the film. Because the people that make films are business-minded, and they're usually men, and they think an action film that's on formula is going to give them back money. It's going to get their returns. But what we are interested in is stories and the enriching, you know, aspects of the community and life, the universe and everything, and telling those stories. And so to get three women and two female lead characters was an amazing feat, and they were happy because 50% of the population is women and about 90% of those women make up the audiences in films, but they're not addressed. There's not that many films made for us. So everybody was very pleased that The Dressmaker was a huge success for all of those reasons. And the men that were handing out the money to Sue, even when she went and said, oh, I've got Kate Winslet and Judy Davis, they went, but who's your male lead? And they would not give her any money until she came up with a bankable male lead, despite the fact that she had all those other people on. So we are disproportionately pleased with ourselves on behalf of all the women, and we hope it sets a trend, and we hope that there's more films with strong female leads. But our biggest joy was the fact that blokes went and came out and went, you know, when I was going to come and see a film called The Dressmaker, I thought, oh, God, you know. And blokes came out and said, but it's got something for everything. So we were really happy that the other percentage of the population enjoyed it too. Men laugh at different things to ladies. So, yeah, go the girls.
Yeah. Go girls indeed. Mm. Now, who else has got a...
Oh, hi, I'm Julie. I'm going to go completely off track here and go on to There Should Be More Dancing.
Oh, yes.
I'd just love to know, I work in the community with old people, basically in the same area and setting, so it really rang a bell with me, that novel. But I was just wondering what the inspiration and where that all came from, because it's just a marvellous, the characters and stuff, and if it is going anywhere else along the line with that as well.
There Should Be More Dancing revolves around a little old lady called Marjorie, who's 79 years old, and she's sitting on the 43rd floor of a high-rise apartment thinking that she might jump because she's lived her life according to the wisdom of desktop calendars, and now she's wondering what went wrong. But it's not... It doesn't end badly. It's okay. But I worked in aged care for about on and off for about 20 years, and I learned most of what I know from those elderly people. I learned everything, probably, about how to make a life worthwhile, about compassion, about loyalty, about disintegration.
Families.
Oh, my God, the families. Jeez. All those sorts of things I learned. And so, again, that was an homage to that. And people don't write books about that very much. And I thought it was about time somebody wrote a book with a 79-year-old female protagonist. But that that is my favourite book, that book, because I desperately loved Walter and Marjorie and their whole life together, and I'm really pleased that you like that book, because I do too. Yeah, but people often think it's sad and somber, and I go, no, you've got to have it. It's funny. You've got to tweak up your sense of humour.
Rosalie, I'm going to read it, and I'm going to invite you back when I'm back.
Oh, I hate you.
Truly,
yeah.
No, I am.
But you don't tell him what happens in the end.
I love what you said. I'd love to read that. I love Room. The title too. We got some questions from this end. Sorry, we didn't mean to. Ignore.
My name is Philip, and an ordinary bloke. I really enjoyed the film too, and even seeing the dresses down at Winchelsea in the mansion there.
Excellent.
You may have answered the question when you talked about the village in Moscow, in Russia or Italy, but how was the book and the film accepted overseas as what we would say quintessentially Australian small town?
I think everybody went consciously into that film knowing it was an Australian film. And people have ideas about Australia in their mind. They think that it's got kangaroos and it's got a desert and it's got gum trees and kangaroos and things like that. And so they may be the principal things they've got in their mind. Oh, thanks very much. But what they know is that it's not of their culture, and it's of a different culture. So they know that at the outset. And I think that they're surprised and delighted, from what I can gather, when they do find that it is quite similar. They are kind of stereotypical characters. There's a curtain twitcher in my street. She knows exactly what time I left tonight. There's a lady that lives down the street in a warping house, and I've got Marigold Pettyman, not terribly far away from you, I tell you. My God, that woman. It has. Not to the huge, huge degree. The United Kingdom and the United States of America didn't quite get it. But it's ticking over just quietly through DVDs and things. Yeah, but it was pretty popular in some countries.
Bernadette, do we have any other questions? No? Are you all done? I feel like the guy coming at the option. Could you please thank Rosalie, the dressmaker, Ham.
Thank you.